Welcome into the Cyclone Hockey Show presented by Pizza Pit. Thanks for tuning in to the show for another year, as it is the first show of 2018. As always, I'm your host, Mary Rominger, and we have a very exciting show lined up for you tonight. As first, I'll do a quick recap of the weekend that just passed as the University of Illinois came to town. And then later on, amidst the show, we will have an exclusive interview with Coach Mark Huber. And then lastly, at the end of the show, we will have a nice round table with both assistant coaches, Coach Scott Ismond and Coach Huber once again. So thank you again for tuning in, and we will start with the recap. Iowa State suffered an unfortunate sweep this past weekend, and it all started on Friday as the team lost 4-2. And really the big storyline of that game was a tough hit that was hit on forward Tony Uglum. It really changed the momentum of the game, and after that there was a couple retaliation penalties along with just kind of the overall mentality after a tough hit like that has happened to the team, and that put Iowa State on a 5-on-3 penalty kill in the last period of the game, and that's what resulted in the loss. And then the team was able to come back fighting strong on Saturday, and it looked like for a majority of the game, the team would come out with a 3-1 series victory over the over Illinois over the course of the year. And they had a great performance leading up to what was a disappointing loss in overtime. And it was a very similar game to the last time these two teams met, November 4th, as last time Aaron Azevedo had the game-winning goal in overtime. But unfortunately, this time that wasn't able to be made. A couple takeaways from the game. Coach Jason Fairman said that he was proud of how the team battled back and was able to fight back strong despite the outcome of Friday's game. And it definitely was a disappointing loss for the team. Senior goaltender Matt Gedeke also stated that losing in that fashion was really a team builder, and it built the team's character, which will be very crucial in these upcoming weeks as Iowa State will face two top 10 teams in Ohio and Lindenwood. So we will get into more of that later on in the show, and that is all I have for the recap. We are going to take it to a quick break, and then we will be back with that exclusive interview with assistant coach Mark Huber. Thanks for staying tuned to the Cyclone Hockey Show presented by Pizza Pit. I'm joined now on the desk by assistant Cyclone Hockey coach Mark Huber. Thanks for joining us, Coach.
Thanks for having me, Mary. I appreciate it.
And for the first segment, I kind of gave you a recap of the weekend, and the big storyline from the weekend was forward Tony Uglum being hit pretty hard on the ice. There was definitely some blood, definitely a few stitches that had to be sewn up on him. So just kind of give us a quick update on how he's doing.
Tony didn't practice today, which would be a huge loss to us moving forward into this weekend. He's one of our top forwards, and that was a tough way to lose the game last Friday. I'm not completely convinced it was a clean hit. Tony's a big guy, so it could have been an elbow. I'm not 100% sure. But he did have a good amount of blood that showed up on the rink. But that happens in hockey. Mm-hmm. So hopefully we can get him back on the rink as quickly as possible and back into the lineup.
And that is something to be noted. There was no penalty on the hit, as the refs did say it was a clean hit in their eyes. And that's what kind of led into the Cyclones being on the losing end of that, because there were a couple retaliation penalties, a little bit of frustration, and that's what put the Cyclones on the 5-on-3 penalty kill late in the game. But moving on, I mean, you are new to the program this year. It's been very exciting to see how things have been able to develop and change with the new coaching staff, including yourself. As always, Coach Jason Fairman is still the head coach, and we'll get into a little bit of your guys' chemistry and how you guys have worked with each other in the past. But first, I want to start off with something that we've talked about a lot on this show this year, and that's the big transition from last year's team to this year's team, because even though you weren't coaching last season, you do know that there were a lot of crucial seniors that were the core of the team. And this year, there's a lot of new faces that there has been a, had to have have to have been a lot of adjustments for. So just kind of give me your thoughts on how you think the transition is going and how you kind of came into it and what your role was.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is my first year coaching. Mm-hmm. It's pretty big shoes to fill at this level. And it's been a learning experience for me as well. I know last year they had a really good team. They really had a lot of upperclassmen, veteran leadership. And this year, kind of starting out fresh, we had a lot of incoming freshmen. So it's tough, to kind of get those new guys in the swing of things and how we do things here at Iowa State. And also, it's a learning curve for them. They're coming out from juniors. They have to go to class, practice, playing up to 40 to 50 games a year. It's quite an adjustment. It's been quite an adjustment for me as well on the coaching end, being a former player here at Iowa State. So I'm learning a lot. I think it's nothing but up from here, from our team, from our coaching staff, and I think it's been a pretty good year so far.
Definitely, and something that a lot of people don't understand about hockey in terms of the process that it takes to come play at whatever level in college is that you have to go through your years in juniors. And since it's fresh for you, since that's kind of more of a recent move for what you experienced, what can you say just about what it takes to get to that collegiate level, even if it's in the ACHA?
Yeah, it really is a grind. Players spend their whole life, wanting to get to the college level. And when they get here, they find out it's a lot more work than they had initially thought. A lot of our players that come in are 21 years of age as freshmen in college, which, you're about the normal college student usually graduates by 22, mm-hmm. 23. So them being older in school, it's a lot to show about their maturity, as young men. But it's also, they're fresh to taking 12 to 15 credits a semester, which is a pretty big burden. And then you add on workouts and traveling and, practice time. It adds up pretty quick when it comes to their time, on and off the ice. So.
And I want to go back to what you had mentioned about how you played under Coach Jason Fearman, who now you are coaching beside. Kind of talk about what the dynamic is like there. I don't even really know where to begin, what it's like to play under a coach that you are now peers with.
It's a very interesting dynamic. My senior year was his first year here. I think this is his fifth year mm-hmm. total coaching at Iowa State. So obviously it's a very different role. I was the senior captain when he was the head coach. Mm-hmm. Being more with the guys and in the locker room was kind of my role, whereas now my role is the assistant coach. And, I'm looked upon to kind of see what he asked me what I see when it comes to game time. It's a very different dynamic, and I'm still learning it myself, so hopefully it'll come sooner rather than later, but like anything, it takes some time. So.
And you graduated pretty recently here at Iowa State with a business degree in 2014, and my biggest question to you is, how have you seen the team grow since then? Even though that's not too long ago, there has been so many big moves made in order to make this program what it is and make it as professional and as elite as it is. What are some of the differences in management and overall that you've seen since you've graduated and played here?
Absolutely. It's grown immensely. A couple years ago, they made it to the national championship game. This year is our 50th year of Cyclone hockey. Just from top to bottom, it's very professionally well done. Everyone, the players, professional, kind of just top to bottom when it comes to how we operate as a program. It's a very silver lining program here at Iowa State, which I'm sure you probably know, mm-hmm. But we take it seriously. And when we get on the rink, we always mean business.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the national championship appearances that Iowa State has made in these past couple years, a lot of success for the program. And that leads me to the question of, what's kind of your intention of coming back? I mean, it must feel like unfinished business as you guys, when you played on the team, were that close and couldn't get there.
For sure. When I was a senior captain, the main goal, and I think every team since, was to win a national championship. We've been on quite a drought, as you know, and that was kind of my main goal. It was a big pull for me to come back and be an assistant coach here is I really, you know, wanted to be a part of something special. And I think Ames and Iowa State is a special place, and I think we have the team to do it this year as well. Mm-hmm. And just to be a part of something like that is, you know, so, a special bonding experience with guys that, you know, nobody can ever take away from you or the team or the program. So that's my end goal. I hope that's the team's end goal. We're trying to get there one day at a time right now.
Absolutely. And I mean, little do a lot of people know, depending on how much research you've done on Coach Mark Huber, is that he's had quite the life experiences before his arrival here in Ames, Iowa as a Cyclone hockey assistant coach. Tell us a little bit about that. I mean, you've had various acting gigs, including one that was alongside Harry Potter star Daniel Radcliffe. Give us the insight. What brought you there, and everything?
Yeah, for sure. It has always been a dream of mine to chase the acting career. I graduated in Iowa State, like you said, in 14 with a management degree, and I figured, you know, I'm still pretty young. This is the time to at least try something like that. And, you know, so I did like any young actor would do. I got my headshots taken, started sending out my resume. I was lucky enough to land an agent in Virginia Beach. And Virginia is a tax incentive state. So all these Hollywood movie companies will pick up and film in Virginia. And it happened to be a movie called Imperium, which is one of Daniel Radcliffe's latest films or movies. And I actually got the opportunity to audition a couple times and land a small role. And it happened to be right next to him, so I got to know him for 3 days. Very, probably the nicest guys I've ever met. He's not very big. He's only maybe 5 feet tall. He's not a very wow. big guy at all.
You wouldn't know that by seeing it through a lens at all.
Exactly.
That's how most actors are, I would say.
So he's very little, and we kind of just, you know, had a connection. His girlfriend is from Detroit, so he's okay. a big Detroit Red Wings fan.
Okay.
So we kind of just hit it off with talking hockey and talking shop, and, you know, on set it's always hurry up and wait. And mm-hmm. I was always just kind of sitting there hurrying up, you know, waiting, and he happened to be right there next to me. So kind of bonded for 3 days. Mm-hmm. It was kind of a life-changing experience, and kind of got my foot in the door when it comes to Hollywood and the entertainment world.
And I mean, it's not a normal parallel you see between a hockey player and an actor. How did you develop your passion for two completely different and separate career paths?
If a lot of guys know me in the locker room, be a movie quote guy, that's just who I am. I've always been reciting movie lines, comedy, you name it, and I just kind of was a fit. People say I think I have a pretty fun, bubbly personality, and kind of just took it and ran.
As you need to have to be in the acting world, and it's so cool that you've had the success that you've had to be able to come here and kind of, you know, bring it back to where you were in college and really try and get success. And this team needs a coach like you, so it's exciting to have. It's exciting to see this program continue to grow. And now, moving away from that aspect of things, I want to talk about the team season thus far. Clearly, as we mentioned before, the team has faced some adversity just in lineup changes, just in making adjustments as any team does every year, especially in college when you have those, when you only have players for 4 years. What are your thoughts on this season thus far?
The season has definitely been a roller coaster. I don't want to sit here and make excuses by any means, but, you know, we've been plagued with a lot of injuries. We've been really short on the bench, which is taxing for players, you know, more ice time, more tired. We've been plagued with injuries, just lack of depth. We didn't have a good as recruiting year as we had hoped. With that, you mentioned earlier with the transition and losing a lot of, you know, veteran leadership from the past year. Yeah, just a roller coaster, and we're just trying to find a bounce here come the end of the year, and hopefully we get on a hot streak. Both of our goalies have been standing on their head. Despite our losses, Derek Moser and Matt Gedicke, both seniors, both been playing lights out for us all year. So hopefully just kind of jump on their coattails and hopefully they can bring us to the promised land.
Well, things have been going pretty well thus far. I mean, the team is a top 10 team right now, ranked at number 10. So we are excited to see what's to come. We are going to take it to a quick break. Coach Huber will stay on the show with us, and we are going to bring in assistant coach Scott Ismond. But right now, we're going to give you some highlights from this past weekend against the University of Illinois.
Started out with nothing, and I still got most of that. The world ain't giving much, I'm positive, that's a fact. Everybody say be cool, you be paying your dues. Make a long story short, I got nothing to lose. You're grinding, oh yeah.
Welcome my money till I get gold, only if I live more. Welcome my money till I get gold, cause I can't get alone. Understand how the money was spent. My mama told me, boy, you ain't got no sense. 100%, yeah.
Back to the Cyclone Hockey Show presented by Pizza Pit. It is now time for the round table segment, and I am joined alongside assistant coach Scott Ismond, and once again we have assistant coach Mark Huber on the desk. We are going to get right into things as we are going to go around the league and talk about what's going on in the ACHA. We are going to start with the first point of there's a lot of top teams facing little resistance ahead in their schedules.
Oh, this is something we've kind of seen all year as well, too. Mm-hmm. Adrian, Minot State, they've been always at the top, as we've said in past episodes. Who are they really playing at this point in time? You look down the list as far as who's left, Adrian doesn't really have any tough competition, really, in the remaining schedule. Minot has weekend series against Jamestown. With those two teams there and what's ahead of them, hard to think that they're really going to slip from that 1-2 ranking. But they've got, you know, your CSCHL still staying strong, you know, with Lindenwood coming in here this upcoming weekend, and Ohio as well coming in is pretty soon here as well too. So other CSCHL teams, you know, they've still got quite a bit to finish off here before ending the regular season.
Anything to bounce off of that, Coach?
No, I think he nailed it.
Absolutely. And now we're going to move on to the question of, is Adrian a credible national championship front runner? Any of you guys want to take a crack at that one?
To be honest, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I think they don't play anybody, as Coach just alluded to, during the year. I think obviously they have a 21-1 record, but I don't think their schedule matches anywhere near to the Iowa State's strength of schedule. Mm-hmm. And as we've seen in years past, they usually are bounced first and second round. So I don't think they're a credible runner-up at this point.
I think that they're going to make a run for it. I think it's going to be between them and Minot, part of it being kind of where they're going to end up in that final rankings. And we've seen the past few years, that day off has got a huge implication running forward as well, too. I do agree, Iowa State's probably had the toughest strength of schedule here this season. But that also does take a toll on the body as you start getting into what's now alluded to as the dog days of the season. And it's kind of hard to deny kind of the stats that is there with Adrian as well, too. Right now they're seeing 152 goals for and only 26 against. Their starting goaltender is under a goal against per game, which is unspeakable, unheard of. Minot, too, pretty close there. They've got a 26-2 record. comparable stats, 148 goals for, 40 goals against. So ideally, what we'd like to see is a team like maybe Adrian slip to that number four. Hope Iowa State gets it at two or three and see Minot and Adrian go at it before Iowa State sees one of them. But I think you could probably see one of these teams go to the national championship game for sure.
And now moving on to Iowa State and checking in on their season thus far. Let's start with what we've seen from them.
Well, strong start from their goaltending. Derek Moser came in once again after leading the team last season and before that to national championship game. But as we've seen here recently, Matt Gedeke getting five straight starts, kind of proving himself. But at the same time, too, there's a little bit of an issue right now trying to win games. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, whether you let in six goals or two goals, it's a matter of did you win the game or not. And as we kind of talked about a little bit in the first segment there, depth has kind of really been an issue for Iowa State this year compared to past years.
Yeah, and going off of that, what do you think, Coach, has been kind of the mindset in picking which senior goalie to kind of move forward with?
It's been a tough decision all year between the coaching staff, Jason, myself, and Scott, on who the right goalie is to go on at the right time. The tough part is you don't know when a goalie's going to get hot, mm-hmm. and especially come playoff time, you want to ride the hot goalie to the finish. So I think the goalie with the most amount of confidence toward the end of the year is who we're probably going to go with.
That's what's going to come down for them, too. We mm-hmm. talked about the depth. Iowa State right now has three players that have over 20 points in the season with Tony Uglum, Aaron Acevedo, Colton Kramer. None of them are in the top 50 of scoring right now. Now, look at Minot State. I don't think they have a player in the top 50 of scoring either, but they have six players that are over that 20 points per game. So it's that depth that's really going to come in when you talk about these final few weeks of the season.
Yeah, and that was a huge key last year as well as kind of Coach Jason Fairman's. He always said that he was going to ride who was the hot goalie at the time, and that seemed to work for them very well. And as you mentioned, Tony Uglum with 29 points, which will be crucial for him to be back and everyone to stay healthy. Now, moving forward into the CSCHL predictions for the year.
Well, it's going to be a tough road ahead. Iowa State still has Lindenwood, Ohio here at home. They still have the opportunity. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Coach Huber, but they still have an opportunity to win the regular season, defend that. They had an opportunity to lock up the number one seed here this past weekend with Illinois in town, but after losing those two games, definitely does shake it up a little bit. And like last year, it came down to the final game for Iowa State to lock in that regular season championship.
I believe we're still in control of our own destiny. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we have four tough games left in the CSHL, kind of pool play. We'll see.
this is a reason why it's a top conference in the ACHA as well, too. Look at the past 10 years, eight of those years, one of the CSCHL teams has made it to the national championship games. So
right.
It's got the reputation that it does for a good reason. The playoffs are strong every single year for a good reason. Yeah. But I don't know, there might be a reason to maybe not win that playoff championship because it seems whoever does is cursed going to the national tournament.
Mm-hmm. And that is kind of a parallel to what we were just talking about how Iowa State has a tough strength of schedule, and that is because the CSCHL is such a strong conference to be in. And moving forward, as we mentioned, Iowa State is going to see two CSCHL opponents, two top 10 opponents coming up here. And before, there was always that issue of effort, and it seems like that has been kind of turned around and things have been pretty consistent effort-wise. What can you say about that and what you expect from the team in those big games?
You know what? I believe the guys are going to bring the effort from here on out. There's six weeks left in the season, and I don't see anybody leaving it in the room at this point.
And then now moving forward to the weekend ahead around the league, I guess we can start it off with what we've been touching on this entire time. Number 10 Iowa State faces number 3 Lindenwood.
I think this is the third time over the course of the year that Iowa State's playing a number 3 ranked team, so mm-hmm. opportunity here still to jump ahead. I'm assuming that when Ohio comes in here in a few weeks, they're going to be ranked very high as well, too. It's hard to say that a team that's ranked in Missouri State is going to be their off week here over the next three. That's what happens when you have the CSCHL, and right now, all five of the CSCHL teams are ranked in that top 10. So it's going to be the nice thing about the CSCHL is any team can beat any team on any given night. So Iowa State, definitely going to have to try and take that momentum from that they have from Robert Morris, kind of leapfrog over the Illinois weekend and really focus in here after earning that split at Lindenwood will be crucial here to try and pick up the two wins here at home.
And then moving forward to number 7, Colorado facing number 21, Oklahoma.
You know, we played Oklahoma early in the year. We split with them. I don't think you ever count a team out, especially this late in the year. I could see an upset there with Oklahoma beating Colorado.
And you've also seen Colorado putting up some very great scores here this year. We've talked about how they probably sneak their way into maybe even the top 5 over the course of the season, being some really big names and definitely establishing themselves as the school of that state right now.
Yeah, that was a couple of really exciting rivalry in state games that we got to see. And now lastly, for the notable games around the league in this upcoming weekend, number 25 ASU faces number 11 University of Nevada, Las Vegas.
This is going to be the start of, I think, a great rivalry here, kind of a desert rivalry, so to say. ASU with a brand new ace, well, I shouldn't say brand new anymore. I think this may be their second or third year as a Division I team at the ACHA level. UNLV, this is their first season, and they proved coming into Iowa State with a run-and-gun offense, they're going to be forced to reckon with down the stretch here as well, too, and you expect UNLV will make some noise at the national tournament, ASU trying to build something to build upon for next year as well.
All right, well, that's all we have for this segment and the rest of the Cyclone Hockey Show. Thanks for tuning in for another week, and be sure to tune in next week as we will be doing the same thing right here on Tuesday starting at 7:30. Thanks, sir.